Good morning, junior hockey fans. This is Stephen Heisler with HeisHockey.com and the Victorious Hockey Company with today's junior hockey morning show. Today is a new day, December 7th, 2022. Interesting day yesterday in hockey. A lot of things going on around the game. We have a guest scheduled for this morning. It's Steve Donner. He's coming off a phone call right now, another Zoom call. He should be in a few minutes. We'll kind of hold up and wait for him. Not too long. Steve's a good guy. So a lot of things yesterday transpired around the game of hockey. A lot has to do with what's going on within the United States Premier Hockey League. A lot of teams are disgruntled. The league has found a new way to make money, and that is to fine teams for stupid stuff. Nickel and diming guys left and right, rules for thee and not for me. It's become an epidemic, and team owners and operators are beyond frustrated. And they're looking for other alternatives. What else can we possibly do? And that is today's subject. What can USPHL operators do? They signed a non-compete clause, which means basically they cannot operate a team within junior hockey for 2 years after they shut down their USPHL team. So with that said, we went into a lot of things yesterday with a number of team operators. What can you really do? Now, there's been discussions around that league in the last few months about alternatives. The Mountain Group thinks they're going to get the NCDC next year. Frankly, I'm not sure the NCDC is going to even exist as we know it. Right now, it's funded. A lot of the funding comes from all the players in all the different leagues at the Premier, the Elite, the youth levels, and each player pays a bit of a kickback back to the league. Some of that league money goes back to the teams operating NCDC teams. That was their funding plan at the beginning. Not sure how that's working now. Teams have left, but the core group of operators from the USPHL, that EGHL group that was under Esdale in the past, is still the core principals. South Shore, Hitman, Boston Junior Bruins, and that group, the Islanders, I think that's still the core owners of the USPHL. And if you're playing hockey in Bellingham or Seattle or LA or Utah or Florida, under their brand, you're paying for those teams back east. Slightly. A lot of the problems have to do with accountability within the group. Team owners have expressed the desire to see what's going on with the money, and the league's been less than forthcoming regarding that, which calls into question. Teams are paying taxes on money they're not receiving from the league, especially in Massachusetts area and Connecticut. So those are very problems that are not having a solution. So what are guys to do? What can you really, really do? And that's today's topic on HeisHockey.com is USPHL club exit strategy is Commissioner Bob Turow's dilemma. And it really is. Bob Turow is not Richard Gallant. Just not. Richard Gallant ruled the USPHL with a bit of an iron fist. Richard and I were not friends by any stretch of the imagination. But Richard had respect for me to some extent. I respected him a lot because the law firm of Cole Schatz and I were on a first name basis. That's not the case with Bob Turow. Bob Turow has a problem with telling the truth about anything. I mean, changes the story from left to right. What's going on? It changes from day to day. It's just not been very good for anybody in the league. And it's become problematic beyond control. We talk about the nickel and diming of fines. We're talking about unequal disciplinary system. Certain operators can get away with anything they want. Others can't get away with anything. He folds teams without just cause or any due process whatsoever. And the overall lack of control regarding operation standards for teams and procedures is ridiculous. Look, you can't have one team going to games in vans and tossing out bologna sandwiches as a pre-game meal, and then another team at the same level of play feeding the guys at Olive Garden, and that's equal. It's not equal. So when you have one team operating at one level and one team operating at another, the chain, the whole part of that ladder of development, that whole level of play, that whole division is broken. One weak link makes the developmental opportunity for everybody in that division worthless. And that's what's happening. You can't win a game 15-0 and outshoot a team 100-6 and think that's going to be good developmentally. And that's exactly what happens when players start figuring out that these guys are cutting corners. It's not what we paid for. And that's been the epidemic in junior hockey, not just at the USPHL level, but other levels as well. There are no standards, and that's an issue. So teams can and often will do whatever they want to do. And that's not good for business. It's not good for hockey. And there's very minimal directions. So why continue with this charade? Why continue going down this road? Why continue paying Boston all of this money when there's very little accountability in the process? So we talked about the USPHL's club agreements that prohibits future operation of junior programs at the same level of play for 2 years. So what can operators really do? And that's been a discussion yesterday and day before and last week, and here's what we come up with. There's another level of play that clubs can really slide into and compete right away. USA Hockey's adult level of play can be the perfect alternative for you guys. Players must turn 18 before December 31st of the current season. That works. Import restrictions are minimal, and you can actually deregulate the whole level of play. There's no need for all the regulation that you guys have now. Why not just have a 24-man roster? Charge what you want to charge, pay what you want to pay, and basically operate without all the regulation. Pay your referees at the end of the night for your games. Get to the games the way you see fit. Operate the way you see fit. And get out of the business of trying to do more than what you can do and tolerating operators that don't do anything at all. So a deregulated system would put everybody into the same category. You create your schedules. You play your games. You have your rosters. Easy enough. You don't have to go through all these things. You don't have to go to Boston and do those things. You don't have to sign a contract with Hockey TV. You can do what's best for your own organization. That's what makes the most sense. Do what's best for you. The key is you got to have players. You got to have a rink. You got to have those things in place, and you're off to the races. Being overcomplicated with all these things that Turow's insisting on doesn't make any sense. It doesn't do anything for you developmentally. Yes. I understand the need to have an accurate website. I understand the need to have pictures and do all these things. That's all very pretty. Very nice, Bob. But what works for the Florida Eels may not be appropriate for the Utah Outliers or Vernon Oilers. It's irrelevant. Let these guys operate the way they want to operate. So how would clubs begin this process? How could you transition from being a USPHL program to being a USA Hockey adult program? And what if you have more than one team? What do you do? Discussion in the last 48 hours and I can talk, was still have your A team and over team with no ceiling. You can have 40-year-olds if you want to, if they want to play. Players can have to turn 18 before December 31st of the current season. If you must operate teams at lower levels of play, say at 16s and 18s, if you need that extra cash flow, then why not do that like a house program where your group of teams, say you're in the Southeast, and you have six operators doing the same thing, then those six operators operate an in-house league at 16 and 18, register the same way you do a house hockey league, and you're done. You don't have to play AAA to provide a AAA level experience. Have a closed experience. Run more of a junior type of schedule with those age groups, the same thing you're doing now with the elite and some guys with the premier. It just makes sense. Not every 40-year-old is going to pay to play hockey. We understand that. So the bulk of your players will probably be 18 to 22, 23 years old. And it's a good possibility. So one of the discussions, one of the ideas we had was to communicate with the Federal Prospects Hockey League. The FPHL is a semi-pro, amateur pro league. Some players are pro, sort of. Some players are amateur, some players are rookies. I talked to Commissioner Don Kernan yesterday about this. Don Kernan was very forthcoming, said that he would be more than interested to facilitate guys that wanted to jump over from the junior level to a amateur, maybe a second division, a second tier of the FPHL, and they would facilitate that under their banner. That can be a positive experience for you guys. I don't think you need to have franchise fees. We talked about a low monthly fee for administration, maybe $500 a month, which is like $6,000 a year, which is much less than what you guys are paying now for a lot less. So pretty much everything you're getting, aside from Bob's overzealous brand of commissioning and being a leader, you would get this from the FPHL. It would also provide an opportunity for your players that aren't really college-bound players to get opportunities within the FPHL and move up to pro ranks if they wanted to do that. So the excitement from the FPHL guys was pretty evident. Steve Donner is supposed to be on this morning. He may still show up. He was excited about the idea. Other guys within the FPHL seemed to be excited as well. And it simply makes sense to be able to operate in this direction, able to begin to build markets. If a team is doing well at the amateur level and they're drawing fans, there's no reason why they couldn't elevate to the FPHL if that's what they wanted to do. And there's no rule within the FPHL that says you have to pay guys. You don't have to. The NCAA is clear. If you give the guys all the same stipend and those kids track those expenses and they're all for approved NCAA expenses, you're still an amateur club. And operating under USA Hockey gives you a lot more benefits than operating outside of it. So we talked about town teams in the past, and this is pretty much what this was in the past. So operators around the country and around Canada, there were fantastic teams that operated in the same manner. Warwell Lakers is the picture we used today on the HighSockey.com article. And Warwell Lakers were the Allen Cup champions back in 95 or something like that. The Allen Cup was the Amateur Hockey Championship of Canada at the adult level. Fantastic tournament. We had this in the United States for many, many years. Teams like the Fond du Lac Bears and those guys were all part of that. Steve Donner, can you hear me? All right. Steve's in the show. So please welcome Steve Donner, straight off a Zoom call from Elmira, New York. Very balmy, warm, 85 degrees in Elmira today in his office.
Yeah, I wish, Steve. I wish. I miss Orlando for sure.
Orlando misses you. You were a big part of what happened in Orlando for soccer, for hockey, and all these things over the years. And it's just been a blessing to have you around here and have you part of the game. Let's back up a little bit and talk to Steve Steve is the current owner of the Elmira Mammoth of the Federal Prospects Hockey League. Steve, we kind of touched base a little bit about the USPHL's dilemma and the idea of those teams going to senior hockey from junior hockey and under the FPHL brand. I said that we did talk to Don Kerning yesterday, and Don was amazingly receptive to the idea. I think we both discussed that it would provide a lot of opportunities for the current FPHL guys for player recruitments, moving kids up, giving them opportunities, and a wider player pool.
Yeah.
So let's get back to you a little bit. When did you first start getting involved in hockey?
Oh, my Lord. Do we have to go back that far?
Back in the 30s, wasn't it?
No. Yeah, it seems that way. You know, I all the way back to the early 80s, you know, when hockey and hockey marketing was just really developing, quite honestly. And I played 4 years of college, you know, in Dayton, Ohio. At the time was a Division I NCAA school. And they had a team in the old IHL, the Dayton Gems, for many years. The Gems had folded, you know, in my sophomore year of college. And then senior year, they announced they're bringing a team back. And so I just, you know, there wasn't internet back then. There, you know, there we had to do the old-fashioned contact, either telephone or send a letter. And I sent a letter to the general manager and told him that I wanted to either be, you know, his best salesman or, you know, his best goalie. And so he got a big kick out of it and called me the next day. He said, get in here. And he was giving me a lecture on minor league hockey and, you know, what makes you think you can, you know, do this and that. And so I'll make a long story short. He said, I'll tell you what. You know, I'll put you to work in the front office, learning this side of the business. You know, come September, you feel you can, you know, win a spot at camp. If you do a good enough job selling tickets, I'll let you come to training camp. So I did. So I right out of school, I, you know, and had wonderful training back then, Steve. You know, coming out of college, my first day on the job, I was excited what my training program was going to be. And I found out my training program was going to be, here's your desk, you know, here's your phone. Here's your call list. It's a big fat phone book. Good luck. Good luck selling hockey tickets. And so, you know, I realized then in the minor league sports back then, there wasn't really, you know, marketing. There wasn't really sales forces and training. And so I just had to find my way. Thankfully, I was really passionate about the game. And I just used my passion to, you know, get in there and do anything I could do to sell tickets and sponsorship. And I learned, you know, the boss I had was the best and the worst. He was like a Barnum and Bailey, you know, promoter in his own way. And he wasn't the most honest gentleman. So, you know, I learned a lot of good things on marketing tricks, and I learned how to be a better businessman by being more honest. And, you know, and as expansion team, we did a little bit of everything that year. And I actually did suit up for 8 games as backup goalie. And I was, you know, top salesman. I was the mascot. I was a color man on the radio play-by-play. So it really launched my whole sports career, you know, in minor league hockey for the Dayton Gems and the IHL. And that's where it all started.
I can't believe you're saying that team owners are sometimes dishonest. That's just mind-blowing, you know.
it was my first foray into hockey, and I found out pretty quickly.
Amazing. So you started out on the management side, got into it. When is the first team that you decided to be an owner?
So I was working for the Buffalo Sabres for 10 years, you know, and I was their VP of marketing, and I loved it. You know, it was the National Hockey League. It was close to my hometown in Rochester, New York. And at the same time, they were very conservative owners at the time, the Knox family, which was like family. And I realized later that I wish it was that way today, because you felt you could work there your entire life. They were honest. They were community-based, treated their people like family. And now it's not that way in sports, unfortunately. But I got called on a headhunter one day about a struggling team in Tampa Bay, Florida, that Phil Esposito tried to start. And,
you know, it was really struggling.
I think when they called me, they only had 5 employees. They had no place to play, no office space. And they were 6 months away from playing a game in the National Hockey League. So I went down and interviewed with, you know, 10 different people. And I wasn't prepared for it, but they offered me the job right away to sort of basically build the front office in the marketing of Tampa Bay Lightning. And so you know, it was February, you know, it was 2 feet of snow in Buffalo, and it was 72 and sunny at Clearwater Beach when they took me out for lunch and everything. But I said, at my age, you know, I was looking for the biggest challenge of my life. The Sabres were wonderful, but a little conservative. And so, you know how they say, be careful what you wish for. I wanted the biggest challenge I could find. And I took it, you know, and went after building the Tampa Bay Lightning. And it was the best and the worst of everything in my life. You know, we had 6 months to take a team that was on the doorstep of death and to try to make, you know, a breathing live entity out of it, an exciting entity. And at the same time, you know, we did have the biggest budget I ever had to work with. So I had a $2 million advertising budget. And in Buffalo, I think I had $250,000, you know. And so, you know, it was so cool because there was no history in Tampa. There was no interest in Tampa, quite honestly. They were looking to get a baseball team, if you recall, at the time. You know, they built the Dome in St. Petersburg, which we ended up playing there. And so I had to talk people into, you know, what's hockey and why are you coming here? We want baseball. But it allowed me to try every marketing tool, every marketing trick. You know, and we had to scrape and claw for everything we did there, Steve. But what was so inspiring for me, and it sort of renewed my passion for the game, is we were watching fans get turned on to hockey one at a time, literally one at a time sometimes. And to see the lights go on, you know, to the fans in Florida, to see people going from disinterest or indifference to just passionate hockey fans, you know, 500 here, 1,000 here. You know, it really inspired my, the rest of my career. I said, boy, you know, why don't teams that are in mature markets go after fan interest like you do in an expansion market that people don't care? If we treated all our fans in mature markets the way we treat new fans in a new market, I think all of our organizations would be stronger, right? Because we take for granted sometimes in a mature market that the fan support should be there. So we went, you know, had a great successful year in our first year. You know, second year, right at the end of their first year, actually, ownership came to me and said, this has been great. We've sold out 10,000 seats in the fairgrounds here in Tampa, but we can't make it long term. It's not big enough. We're going to go into the Dome in St. Petersburg next year. I was like, next year? Like in 90 days from now? You know, he said, yeah. And you know, so I had to put together a marketing plan to go from 10,000 seats to 28,000 seats. And it actually was 99 days was exactly the number of days we had. And they had never had ice in the Dome before. We weren't even sure we could maintain ice in the Dome. And we had all the space. And so I just sat down and came by. It was really a lot of fun, actually, even though it was quite stressful. I just came up with a plan to say, well, you know we don't have 28,000 hockey fans. You know, what can we do to interest larger crowds to come to see a hockey game, you know, in Florida, of all places? So we really took a page out of Disney's book, and we tried to be the most aggressive marketing team in hockey. We built this 100,000 square foot fan land out what would have been left center field in the baseball configuration, and literally made an interactive theme park for fans, you know, in the arena. So if the fans came out to a game on a game night, they wouldn't have to come just for hockey. They could come for a full night of, you know, we'd have music before, we'd have private clubs, we'd have, you know, anything interactive you could think of, even like, you know, 60-foot slides and, you know, merry-go-rounds and, you know, pinball and, you know, table hockey, you know, basketball, you name it. You know, you could kick a 35-yard field goal. You know, it was daring and it was scary. You know, I'll never forget opening night. You know, I was worried if people would actually come and see Fanland. So we opened the gates 2 hours early before the game. We opened the doors. We got the radio alert that the doors were opening, and literally there was like a thundering noise. People were by the hundreds running down the hallway to try to be the first ones in Fanland. So after 5 minutes of the gates being open, there was like 4,000 people, you know, in Fanland. It was so cool. And so that took off. We're having a great year. And I got a call back from the Buffalo Sabres and said they were building a new arena in Buffalo. They were going to have to sell off some of the assets that weren't doing as well, and I have any interest to buy my hometown team, the Rochester Americans, in American Hockey League. And as much as I was, loving, you know, the experience in Tampa, you know, growing up, the Rochester Americans were like the New York Rangers to us. You know, I grew up there. They were
perennial Calder Cup contenders, and it was like another NHL, mini NHL team. So to have the thrill to go in my hometown and buy that team, that was the thing that got me into ownership.
And that was a fantastic move there. You also got, somehow you got roped into getting involved in soccer. What folks may not know is the last non-major league soccer team was when the U.S. Open Cup was owned by Steve Donner in Rochester Rhinos. Tell us about that story.
Yeah, that was amazing. And so we, when I went to Rochester, you know, they hadn't had a new sport in probably 50 years. You know, they had the hockey team and the baseball team. The market over a million people. And, you know, so, you know, I experimented with, I brought pro lacrosse to Rochester. It was an instant hit. It was indoor lacrosse, only, you know, 8 home games. So it wasn't, you know, a taxing number of games to add to our hockey schedule. But the fan support, you know, was sold out every night, you know, immediately for that. And a good friend of mine in the marketplace was a passionate soccer fan. And he and I, you know, we grew up watching the Rochester Lancers, the old NASL, in Rochester, and then they folded after many years. And after the team folded, the passion for soccer never stopped in Rochester. And on the organic side, the youth levels, you know, had blossomed in amazing numbers for a city of its size. And in the summertime, we had the baseball team, and they did a great job, you know, marketing. But it was, you know, only baseball the summer. Not to say only baseball, but you know, we were looking at, you know, the MLS was just about to get off the ground then. So soccer was, you know, back on the radar of a lot of people. There was a league called the A-League before it was the USL. And they had, I think, either 5 teams or 7 teams. They needed an additional team to round out their league. And so we were looking at indoor soccer. We were looking at a number of different other things. And, you know, we came to the conclusion. Actually, we're at a baseball game. It was Little League Baseball night in August in Rochester. And there were 8,000 people, you know, at the baseball game with our kids. And, you know, no offense to the baseball crowd, but the baseball game itself was probably the most boring sporting event I'd been to all summer. But it didn't matter. Like, the kids were having a ball. You know, people were having their hot dogs, and they were out in the nice evening air. And I looked to my friend and partner. I said, you can't tell me, if done right, professional soccer couldn't be more exciting than this, you know. And so that was that night at that game, we decided to bring professional soccer to Rochester. And at the same time, Rochester was kicking around building a new baseball stadium. And we got a tremendous gift. You know, we negotiated. Everyone was excited to bring pro soccer there. We were going to be I think it was the 8th team in the A-League. And I remember sitting down with the baseball team, and they were concerned that we would draw enough fans for them to open the concession stands. I'm like, well, my goal is to outdraw you guys. My goal, we only have 15 home games to your 70. You know, my goal is to have bigger crowds average for my games than yours. And they sort of laughed at me. Okay. So, you know, they gave us backhandedly a really huge gift. So the stadium, as sometimes happens with stadium projects, the stadium opening was delayed, and it, you know, could not open in April, and it wasn't going to open until July. And so they felt it was, they didn't want to move their season mid-season to the stadium. They were going to wait till the following year to move over to the new stadium. The county was totally panicked because, you know, they had expenses ongoing for the stadium. Didn't want to see the stadium empty for the summer. And they said, well, we'll go and we'll play our rest of our schedule there. So we backloaded our schedule as best we could into the second half of the season. Only played, I think, 4 home games to start the year. We played in a small 5,000 seat college stadium, University of Rochester Stadium. So, you know, we got the team started. We were actually, I think, 1-4, 1-5, didn't get off the greatest start. Makes similar to the start I got off the hockey team this year in Elmira, honestly. And then, you know, we sold out the first game of 5,000 seats at the, but it was a, you know, it was an old stadium and old head bleachers. So we did like 3,000 to 4,000 the next 2 games. And then we were leading up to our opening game in the new stadium. And my God, Steve, it was right out of a movie, you know. So it was a beautiful July night, you know, with the hype of the stadium, certainly not for soccer, but for the hype of the stadium, we drew 15,000 fans to the opening of the stadium. And we were playing the league champion Montreal Impact, which is now obviously an MLS team. They were very strong. They were the dominant team in that league.
We were down 2-0 at half, and my partner, Chris Economides, was ready to jump off the sweet bridge and kill himself, I think. And I walked him off the ledge and said, hey, you know, let's look at the crowd. Doesn't matter win or lose tonight. You know, we've all won here in Rochester. And the second half, you know, we start picking away. We get a goal. It's 2-1. Less than 5 minutes left in regulation time. We tie the game up, and the place went crazy. You know, that we tie, we're going to go into extra time, and we go into the first minute of extra time, score the game winner. You know, the player took his jersey off, was going around bare chest and whipping the jersey around his head, got a yellow card, of course. And soccer was born in Rochester. It just took off like a rocket. And, you know, every game that day forward, that first year, we were averaging over 12,000 fans a game. We actually came back and, you know, went to the Open Cup final in our very first year, if you can believe that, against, I think it was the New York Cosmos. And I know it was not. It was actually the Washington team.
Yeah.
We played RFK Stadium. So we took a couple of kicks of the can, you know, and before we won the Open Cup, we were actually in the final twice, you know, prior to that. And then we finally did it, you know, years later.
So you left sports for a little while and you came back with the Greenville Swamp Rabbit a couple of years ago. What, you know, brought you back to the game?
Well, it was my wife, quite honestly, because, you know, we were down in Florida, you know, not that I was going to retire, but I was doing sports consulting down there and, you know, took over the Daytona Ice Arena and had a hot junior hockey program. And my sons were of junior age. And so, you know, I wanted to sort of live vicariously and support them. But my youngest son, Mac, you know, when we had our long run in sports, was so young, he never got to really experience it like the rest of the kids. So my wife actually said, you know, why don't we do one more sports project? Mackie's old enough now to sort of be around it. And I said, well, let's do it in a warm climate though. You know, I don't want to go back up north. And so we looked at Greenville and, you know, it fit a lot of, checked the boxes for her. That was a little more north so that we had a little bit of wet weather in the winter, a little bit of snow, maybe an inch or two. And for me, it was mainly a temperate climate, nice city. But a challenging market, you know, and hockey there for a number of years, prior ownership. And so we had the challenge of rebuilding it. And we did, you know, we raised attendance. We doubled and maybe tripled attendance. We took the losses from multi-million dollars down to a few hundred thousand dollars a year. And then COVID hit. And, you know, we just felt, especially in that market there, that one thing I'd learned getting back into minor league sports is that your lease can kill you. You know, it either makes you or breaks you. And beautiful building, but our lease was very, very unattractive. And I tried to make changes, thought we'd build a relationship there, make changes the better. When I realized it was always going to be a struggle, you know, I decided to sell our interest there and look for a project that we could control. And that's what brought us to Elmira, because the building was closed. It's a nice, beautiful 4,000-seat building. And it has 31 suites, two restaurants, a practice rink attached to it. And they were looking for someone to revitalize it, you know, bring activities, sports, and entertainment back. And we control everything. We control concessions. We control the advertising, the suites, naming rights, practice rink. And so I've got family up here. And it was also part of a strategic move is we're going to bring pro lacrosse back in at the American League level. We thought it would be a great building to sort of help kick off the lacrosse league. So come full circle, back up north, but we're in a building that we can control and, you know, we're happy. Other than the weather, you know, we're very happy with what we're building here in Elmira.
So the budget's comparing the Federal Prospects Leagues to the ECHL, how dramatic difference is it?
Yeah, that's a great question. And it's sort of both a good answer and a sad answer. So ECHL has let their expenses get out of control, in my opinion, and they're trying to be a league, you know, that they can't be. Maybe, you know, the budgets in America, in the East Coast League now are $3 million plus. It could be three, it could be 3.5. Some are even closer to four. You know, in the Federal Hockey League, they're all under $1 million. You know, in most cases, you know, I'd say between $500,000 $800,000 a team. And, you know, it's a league that allows the owners to definitely, you know, run a profitable business. And I think what we're just trying to do now in the FPHL is improve our ownership, get our owners committed to, you know, higher standards, I would say. But the league, from a competitive standpoint, the level of play has increased dramatically from what it was 5 years ago. We're in better cities. You know, a lot of the teams that are going into now are former either AHL or ECHL cities with a much more inexpensive business model. And I think, you know, I think that's the last bastion of hockey where owners can, independent owners can actually make money.
Do you feel that the concept that we're talking about today, with the amateur league operating within the structure of the FPHL, is beneficial for the league, and how would that help the operators?
Yeah, I think it could be very beneficial for the league, and hopefully, you know, for players as well. I mean, the one downside that we don't have a recruiting source or development source of players directly. You know, where other leagues use us as a development source and direct player pool source, we don't have that. So we're always begging, borrowing, stealing, being creative as to where we get our players from. Some players that, you know, that would like to come to us right out of juniors, you know, aren't quite developed enough to really play pro hockey. Some can. Some are making the jump. But we want to encourage most of those guys to go into college. But there's, you know, as we both know, there's a certain level of player 18 years and older, maybe not cut out for college hockey, maybe, you know, their game is better suited, you know, to develop for pro hockey. So I think if it's done right, you know, maybe it would sort of pare down the number of junior teams out there, because there's way too many junior teams, and having a, you know, a senior circuit with the focus on developing players for us in the SPHL. I think, you know, if it's done well, you know, it could be a really good idea.
I don't see any reason why those kids still couldn't be on the college path as well, and kind of decide, maybe at 21, 22, hey, you know what, I'm done with this, I want to go to college and play, and they still can't.
Yeah, good point. Yeah, that's a really good point. It gives them an option, quite honestly. Yeah, that's a good point. I was thinking initially just more from the FPHL side and the per diems that the players have paid, but if it's completely amateur and a senior, you're 100% right, that path would still be open.
I like the idea. I think it's good for hockey, and it kind of brings the game full circle. I don't know if you remember the War World Lakers and the old Anchorage Aces and Fairbanks Gold Kings. They were all senior teams on the West Coast. Mm-hmm. And that's how they started. When they went to professional hockey, you know, it kind of lost that hometown feel. A lot of those guys were from either played college hockey there or high school and club hockey there, and they went onto the Aces or the Gold Kings or Fresno Monsters. Falcons back then. So these were good teams and guys that you could see and meet and work to the community, and getting back to that would be fantastic. And I like the idea, and I think it gives these guys that are struggling a way to continue operating and operating at a higher level.
Yeah. Well, it's nice, you know, for gentlemen like us that we've been around the game, you know, we've seen all variations of it, and there's some things we can learn from the past, you know, that we could look to bring back and bring it back in a way that helps the game today. So I know, Steve, you're always, man, you're never short of outside-the-box thinking, you know, so I've always applauded you, and I know sometimes that thinking doesn't always not get you in trouble with some institutions and things, but I applaud you for, you know, you've always been a person looking out for the young player. You're looking to help them develop, and you're looking to always improve the game. So I appreciate your thoughts always, and you know, you come up with some always great ideas, and this one could be one of those, actually.
Very good. Well, thank you very much, Steve. Let's close up today's show. 40 minutes, guys, after surgery on Sunday, I did a 40-minute show. God, I don't know how that worked out.
I can't believe you've done 40 minutes with your voice after having surgery in your throat area. So good for you. That's testament to your resolve here.
Or something, or good drugs. Really good drugs. All right. Thank you very much, Steve. God bless you, man.
Yeah, have a great day, Steve.
That was Steve Donner with the Elmira Mammoth of the Federal Prospects Hockey League. Let's wrap up today's show. It's 9:40 a.m. We pulled this one off. Appreciate your help. Again, if you want to be on the show, if you want to provide some background images for us, if you want to give me a hat, whatever you want to do, questions, concerns, complaints, drop me a line. Either on the Facebook group, you can hit me on Twitter, you can call me, you can do whatever you want. But let's wrap up today. This is Stephen Heisler with HeisHockey.com and the Victorious Hockey Company. You've been watching the Junior Hockey Morning Show on the World Sports Broadcasting Network. And we hope that you today have a great day in hockey. God bless you.